everybody. Welcome to another great installation of GeekGirlCon's Month of Science Fiction. Today's stream combines the theme of science fiction with also mental health awareness, since it's Mental Health Month. So yay, and before I forget, GeekGirlCon is still fundraising through Give Big, so if we could put that command in the chat, that would be awesome. For our live in-person con, so if you want to donate to our, entirely volunteer-run organization, that is a place that you can do that. So, and thank you in advance. So today's stream is called Psych-Fi, Storytelling Your Way to Mental Health. And we'll be talking about the science of the brain and the psychological appeal of science fiction, and also how science fiction reading and writing, storytelling can impact the patterns in your brain and neural connections and improve your mental health and kind of help you heal. So we'll do some introductions real quick and then have an icebreaker question, and then we'll get into some Psych-Fi. My name is Emerald, pronouns she, her, and I am on the social media team for GeekGirlCon. And I have here with me my lovely mother. So happy belated Mother's Day, Mom. Aww. You're just a dream for me. And I'll let you introduce yourself. So if you want to say who you are, your pronouns, and a little bit kind of about what you do, and then you can toss the ball back over to me, and then I'll toss it back to you, and you can tell us all about funky psychology, brain, sci-fi stuff.
Hi, I'm Geralyn, she, her. I'm a mental health counselor. Been a counselor for over 25 years, and I use storytelling and science fiction, not science fiction, all sorts of fiction actually, to help my clients sometimes. So that's what I wanted to talk about today.
Awesome. So I wanted to kind of ask you this, and I know I prepped you, but then I realized that I forgot to think about this question, as I thought before you start to tell us all about that. We could each share kind of one of our favorite science fiction stories and why it appeals to us or why we relate to it. And chat, you can get in on this too. If you have a favorite science fiction story, it could be a movie, a book, short story, whatever fan base that you're into, and maybe why you like it so much. And I'll try to think of one for me. So Mom, I'll let you go first. Favorite sci-fi story and why?
And because I can't limit myself to one, I'll say two, but I'll say them quickly. My favorite is A Wrinkle in Time, probably, because that was my introduction to science fiction. And I liked it because the a teenage girl who didn't have any special powers. She didn't know how to swing a sword. It was kind of like a regular person, and how, you can still change the world being a regular person. And another favorite of mine that I buy every used copy I can find because it's out of print is called Clever Lazy, The Girl Who Invented Herself. And it just talks about how sometimes being lazy is just your brain working and becoming clever. You need that time to become clever.
Awesome. So I thought about it, and my favorite science fiction story, well, one of my favorite science fiction stories is a short story by Connie Willis called All Seated on the Ground. Mom, I know you have read this, where aliens come to Earth, and they don't want to take over the world. They don't want to fight. They're not there on a diplomatic mission. They just come to Earth and they're And everybody on Earth is aliens, what? And they're trying to commute. At first it's everybody defensive. And then the mayor goes to greet them. And then, the president, and then the, you know, United Nations, and they're all just like, whatever, they're trying to find a way to. So I think that's, and what I like about that is it's like your expectations kind of like check them, because you never know why someone is doing something. And like, not to spoiler alert it, but it's like they're looking for like proof that like humans can like communicate together, and you should definitely check that out if you're interested. Oh, mom, can you put the microphone closer to your mouth? People are having trouble hearing you.
Oh, shoot. I was afraid of that. Is that better? I can just hold it.
Oh, you read Blood Child by Octavia Butler. She's been on my TBR list for a while. So, yeah. So, now, are you ready for a little bit to get into your story about how our brain works by creating neural pathways, and how sci-fi can, you know, help create new neural pathways? That was repetitive, but tell us about that.
Okay. So the way our brain works is it creates what are called neural pathways. So that's patterns that our brain puts together so that when we get into a similar situation that we just experienced, we know what to do. So if one day we're walking out in the yard and a bee stings us, we feel pain, and that creates a neural pathway that creates a pattern in our brain that says, bees, painful. So next time we see a bee, we don't have to think about it. We run away. And it's also what helps us do things like drive a car. I remember when I first learned to drive a car, I sat in the car and thought, how am I ever going to figure out all of these buttons and levers? And there's so much to do. There's so much to pay attention to in driving. But then I drive so much, my brain creates a neural pathway so that it kind of automatically knows what to do when I drive. So that sometimes now I drive while eating French fries and checking my text messages. Not really, that was a joke.
Please drive safe. No. but that's kind of why, like, sometimes you'll be kind of like on autopilot, right? And you drive somewhere and you'll be like, wow, I don't remember that drive like at all.
Getting here, right. And actually,
it's like an automatic thing.
And it's can be a good thing. Those neural pathways can be a good thing, can be a bad thing. They're just a thing. That's how our brain processes things. So that is also why sometimes we'll get like celebrities mixed up. I have a neural pathway of like, blonde singers who used to be on the Mickey Mouse Club, and then I get them mixed up. Or I have it's why, I don't know if this happens to everybody, but it happens to most people who have at least one sibling, is that your mother's mad at you and she says, Joe Bob, pick, which one are you? Because your mother has a neural pathway for each of her children. And they overlap quite a bit. So the neural pathway for, you know, child one is very similar to the neural pathway for child two. And when we get upset, our neural pathways sometimes don't work quite as well.
Yeah. And they're also maybe like in just the neural pathway of like, goodness, I'm upset with someone, or like.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, so you can, when you get angry, a neural pathway might come up of the last person you were angry at, or the last argument you had with that person, which is why sometimes people do bring up past arguments when they're arguing, or I might get mad.
I call my friend's dog my cat's name when I'm mad at them. Yeah. I'm, get off the, you know, whatever. Yeah, so you can Alyssa says that my mom always called my brother the dog's name. LOL.
And it's also why sometimes, like, I might get angry, and it can be any emotion. You know, I might get angry at my current boyfriend because my last boyfriend did the same thing and it ended up being a really bad thing. You know, my old boyfriend had this funny laugh, and every time he laughed that funny laugh, he was mean. And then my new boyfriend laughs, and all of a sudden I get upset because of that old neural pathway, even though it's a new person.
Mm.
And it's also why, if you know someone really well, you can recognize, like, you can see their, you can hear them cough in Safeway, and you're there like, oh, that's my best friend coughing. I know that cough.
Mm-hmm.
Because repetition is one thing that kind of deepens neural pathways. So hearing that cough over and over again, or a lot of times, like if you live with people, you can tell who's walking up and down the stairs because they walk differently. And you say, oh, that's so-and-so walking up and down the stairs. I know their step. I've heard their step every day. So I dropped something on the floor, so I'm just going to go out of screen for a second. So neural pathways actually have a little bit to do with what Emerald was talking about her science fiction story. We have this idea that if aliens attack, or if aliens come to Earth, they're either here to attack or here to help us. And you know what? Maybe they're just here on vacation, or maybe they're here by accident. But we don't think of that. We respond a certain way because our brain is pre-programmed to respond that way.
So, like, would you say that kind of like societally, society has like kind of a joint neural pathway that, like, oh, if aliens come to Earth, it'll be to, you know, dominate, like to take over, because of how that like sci-fi situation is portrayed in like film and novels and stuff?
Yeah, yeah, exactly. And we have no, I mean, aliens, as far as we know, haven't come to Earth. So we don't have anything to base that on except for some people's imagination.
Imagination, right?
Yeah.
But that's the thing about a neural pathway, though, right? Is like, once it's there, it's easier for it to become like a deeper kind of groove, become a freeway or something, if you will.
Yes. And that's exactly one of the many reasons why we like science fiction, is science fiction challenges those neural pathways. So we say, we've always, you know, communicated by picking up a telephone with connected to the wall with a wire connected to wires on, you know, telephone poles. And then in the 60s, Star Trek came along and had the communicators, or I guess communicators, and they kind of looked like flip phones.
One to beam to sick bay?
Yes. So we go like, oh, a telephone doesn't have to look like this. It can look something like something different. Or communication doesn't have to happen this way. It can look, it can happen a different way.
So people can use their imagination to kind of instigate like real scientific discovery.
Yeah, absolutely. Real scientific discovery, scientific change, and scientific like possibility.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a saying, I wouldn't have seen it. If I hadn't have seen it, I wouldn't have believed it. And then there's also a saying, if I hadn't have believed it, I wouldn't have seen it.
Oh, and this is about the boats thing?
Yeah. When the Spanish sailed to South America, the Aztec, I think, don't quote me on that, had never seen large boats before. So they literally didn't see the boats until they were very, very close to shore, because their brain didn't process what they were, you know. And it's also why
cattail.
Cattail.
Yeah, it's okay, he just wants to lay right under the little desk thing. Oh, no. anyway, keep going.
It's also why, I lost my train of thought.
Sorry.
That's okay. It's also why when you buy a new car and you swear you've never seen that car before, once you buy a new car, all of a sudden you're seeing that car everywhere on the road. It's right. Not because that car all of a sudden got sold to, you know, hundreds of thousands of people. It's because by buying that car, you created a really strong neural pathway that said, I can see this car. And so now you actually see the cars that have always been there.
And like the same if you learn a new word or you read a word in a book, looked this up the other day, called the redundancy phenomenon, like where you think all of a sudden it's I've never seen this word. Okay, now he's trying to knock it up. I've never seen this word before, and now it's everywhere, but really you just didn't even notice it. And now that it's in kind of the forefront of your brain, you have that neural pathway. It's just opened up part of your vision or something.
Right. So science fiction writers, whether that's another author or yourself, forge new neural pathways for us and say, it is possible for aliens to not have eyes, or aliens to have seven senses and not have the sense of sight at all. Mm-hmm. Or it's possible to, again, communicate wirelessly, or it's possible to go faster than the speed of light.
Anything is possible!
Right? But it's hard to believe those things if the neural pathway hasn't already kind of been forged.
Mm-hmm.
A couple of things that make the neural pathways easier to forge. One is, as we've already said, ironically, repetition.
Uh-huh.
So if I do something over and over and over again, that creates a strong neural pathway. The other is an emotional link. So either trauma or the excitement of buying a new car. That kind of creates a neural pathway pretty quickly, or being stung by a bee, that pain creates a neural pathway pretty quickly. And another thing that creates a neural pathway is creativity. So if you're having trouble creating a new neural pathway about a new invention or your own mental health, if you tie in something creative about it, kind of like the title of the book I like, Clever Lazy, if you just kind of let your brain let your mind wander a little bit and daydream about it or tell a story about it, we tend to remember that better. That neural pathway gets more solid.
Mm-hmm.
And that's also why a lot of moral teachings are done in stories, because we'll remember a story about the tortoise and the hare much more than we'll remember it if someone tells us 72 times, slow and steady wins the race, slow and steady wins the race. That's going to take forever for us to believe and for that neural pathway to be created. But if we hear it in story form, we tend to believe it a little more quickly. So that's the beauty and appeal, one of the beauties and one of the appeals of science fiction.
Yeah. Do the Jump says, I really loved Asimov's robot stories.
Yeah.
And Shield of Apollo says, if you want a book about where humans are considered space orcs, help out different aliens, I recommend the anthology Humans Wanted.
Oh, I love that idea. See, that's what I love about science fiction is it does change the way we think and don't even know that we think. And one of my favorite authors, Lois McMaster Bujold, one of the many, many things I like about her, I think she's brilliant. She has a book in which they discover mind reading, which is a very, very common theme.
Mm-hmm. And
the person who learns to read minds, you know,
everyone... Oh, this is great. I love that. I love this story. I just remembered what you're talking about. Ah!
Yeah, yeah. Everyone's trying to kind of recruit him for a spy and for warfare.
Mm-hmm.
And
they're like, oh, perfect. Join our espionage program.
Right. And he's a doctor. Oh, then there's a doctor who is talking to the guy who can read minds and says, oh my God, please come work with me with babies and people with Alzheimer's.
Mm-hmm.
And,
like,
and
you can use the power of, you know, telepathy for, yeah, you know, for other things besides like subterfuge.
Right. Yeah. Besides tricking people or,
mm-hmm,
you know, you can talk to people in a coma. You can talk to sick animals. Then. And it just shifts the way people think about it. So they think more things are possible.
Sorry if my camera is bumping around. It is the cat of the hour, Briscoe, just claiming this tablet holder for his own. He's like, this tablet holder is mine. So, get off. Oh, also, Gazisaurus says that we are twins. I assume she means me and you and not me and Briscoe, but really, it could be either.
Could be either. So,
and he's back. Tail.
Are we kind of ready to transition from then how storytelling and the science fiction idea of creating new neural pathways can help in mental health? Or are there any other questions about neural pathways? It's a really simplistic explanation of them.
Yeah, chat, let us know if you have any questions about how neural pathways are formed, or, you know, any anything about kind of the science part of this stream, because, you know, got an expert right here knows about all the brain stuff. Well, I guess I'm generalizing. You don't know about all the brain stuff. But, you know, if you have any questions about, you know, that type of thing, I will keep my eye on the chat. And yeah, I think we can move on to kind of the science, how science fiction neural pathways specifically and the creativity side of it can help your own mental health, like by representation or like using like a story as some sort of template to kind of like allow yourself like escapism or from a bad situation or like escape a bad situation or like heal or, you know, find your people. Yeah. Oh, Gazzy says you and me.
thank you for clarifying that. Excuse me.
Nobody know all the brain stuff. Yeah, that's right. That's right. Oh, and Gazisaurus says Doctor Who helped me escape and heal. And I think that's a great example.
Yeah.
So now you're gonna tell us about how science fiction and fandom kind of can help us resolve trauma and heal and just overall improve our mental health through that neural pathway of creativity and representation.
Yeah, I'm going to talk about a couple of examples, and then I might read you a little story, and then I was going to ask, I can't see the chats, so Emerald's going to have to take charge of that and maybe help have you all help write a story.
We're going to stay tuned, because we're going to write a little story,
mm-hmm,
and like maybe draw little pictures to go with it, so that's coming.
So one of the reasons that science fiction or helps us kind of accept those neural pathways is that our brain doesn't like new neural pathways, because the whole reason for neural pathways is our brain knows the old way works. So sometimes when we see a new way, we kind of automatically reject it. And again, the ways to get around that are things like repetition, intensity, or, you know, emotional intensity or creativity, which is also why like advertising works. Like, we don't like a new product, but if there's a story behind it or a song behind it, which is creative, we'll listen to it and buy that product. But if somebody just said to us, this product is better than that product, clearly, logically, our brain isn't going to take that in as quickly. It just doesn't. Which is why I think logic is wonderful, but it's not the only thing that our brain uses. Our brain also uses emotion and creativity and everything like that.
Yeah, listen up, Spock.
Right?
Or listen up, Vulcans, I guess.
So one thing to know about the neural pathways is that if we already have a neural pathway created, we can kind of piggyback on that. And again, I can, the best way for me to explain that is to tell a little story. I was seeing a client who was having trouble calming his anger, and he was convinced that he could not calm his anger, that that just wasn't a thing that could be done. And so I talked to him a little bit, got to know him a little bit, and he had played basketball in high school. And he said he was the best person on the team to throw free throws. And I said, wow, that's impressive, because when you throw a free throw, that means somebody just fouled you, right? Hit you with their elbow or something.
Yeah, sports.
Right? And you have all this adrenaline coursing through your body, and you got the crowd cheering, and usually it's like a free point, so don't blow it, all this pressure. And I asked him how he did that, and he kind of went through the process of how he calmed himself to throw a free throw. And I said, well, do that when you're angry. And he kind of, it took longer than that, but he kind of went, ah, you know, I see, I already know how to do this thing to calm myself when my adrenaline is high because of sports. I can now calm myself when my adrenaline is high because of anger. Mm-hmm. I didn't realize that. And it's also why role models are so important. You know, if you can't imagine yourself being a scientist because you don't see anyone who looks like you or acts like you or is like you, being a scientist, it's harder to imagine yourself as a scientist.
That neural path, like pathway, is like brush.
Yeah. So the idea of using creativity and storytelling in counseling is so that people can see their health in a different way, and see themselves in a different way, and see themselves as overcoming their mental health issues, whatever they are. And I first started doing this because I worked with children when I first started in mental health, and with children usually come with parents. So the child and the parent would come into my office, and we would talk about how irritating the child was because he had ADHD, and how frustrated the parent was. And you could see the parent, you could see the child kind of shrink in his chair because he's seeing his mom talk about, you know, all the bad things he's doing, basically. Mm-hmm. You know, and you could also see the mom shrink in her chair because she loves her son, but her son is irritating her, you know? So.
Are you talking about me and Briscoe right now? Cause he's laying on my notes. He's laying on my notes, playing with my power cord. So.
Yes. So Briscoe wants to be near you.
Yeah, he's obsessed with me. What's wrong with you?
So the first thing I did was I talked to the parent. I'm thinking of a particular parent and child. So I was this particular mom and son. The first thing I did was I talked to them about imagining that ADHD was attacking the family, and it was using the son as a conduit, right? And I could see both of them. I could see the mom and son look at each other and kind of go like, "Oh, we got to take this thing down, you know, you and me together." And the mom was there like, "I'm not letting this ADHD thing attack my son." And the son there like, "I got this. I have an ally in my mother of helping me fight off this ADHD thing, which isn't doing me any good either." So the first thing it did almost immediately was it changed kind of this two people against each other with animosity, and also feeling a lot of defeat and a lot of aloneness into a team.
Mm-hmm.
And just that change, just that new neural pathway, which they already knew, how to fight an external enemy, just changed the process of counseling dramatically. And it made it so much easier and, quite honestly, so much more fun. You know, so instead of saying, "What irritating thing did little Jason do yesterday?" We could say, "Oh, did ADHD get into your home again? What kind of locks can we put up?" Or, the mom saying, you know, "Okay, son, what can I do to help you fight off this ADHD disease?" Or however they decided to think of it.
They're like externalizing the problem to,
yeah,
make it not about their relationship, but more about something they can conquer or tackle or work on together.
Right. And it's the same as, you know, shifting from mind reading can only be used in espionage to mind reading can be used for coma patients.
Mm-hmm.
And that just opens up a whole new world. Going from, you know, my son has a mental health issue, and that means we have to be irritated with each other, to my son has a mental health issue and I'm a mama bear and I am not going to let that mental health issue take my son from me.
Mm-hmm.
Rather than, I can't do anything with this boy, you know?
Yeah. They're not like pitted against each other. They're on, right, the same, they're on the same team, because they are on the same team.
And there's an interesting, there's actually several studies that show people in situations that they term hopeless,
mm-hmm,
particularly situations in which battered women, the thing that helps most is changing the woman's perspective into thinking of herself as someone who has choices.
Mm-hmm.
So instead of talking to the battered woman about, this is one particular study again, but there's many studies that are similar.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of talking to the woman about how she deserves to get out, how, let's do a safety plan for getting out, just saying, you know what, tomorrow make three choices that are fully 100% your choice, no matter how small they are. Decide what color socks to wear, decide where to part your hair, it doesn't matter, but start building
those neural pathways.
Exactly.
Flickering the brush with a machete, as somebody said earlier, and that's part of like building a positive habit. It's you're kind of building the habit of making it, of even believing that you have the ability to make a choice.
Yes.
Then with every small success, you know, with every success, like, oh, I successfully chose between, you know, this type of coffee and that type of coffee, or I successfully chose which, you know, which foot to put on the stair first, Yeah. And you're building like that neural pathway of success.
Exactly. Exactly. So after that, I kind of fell in love with the idea, and part of externalizing the problem. Well, we'll get into that. So I think, Emerald, if you're okay with this, I'd like to read the blur and then write a story.
Okay. Yeah, sure.
Or should we read the worry warthog?
I think we should do the blur because I have some of those illustrations from that.
Okay.
Well, Fractal Rainbow says, as a person with ADHD, I don't really feel like it's a monster, demon, disease because it's a part of me. And I want to work with that part of myself, not lock it out or defeat it. It's more like a fairy fae creature, got to appreciate all its power and treat it with respect. Because ADHD people are also uniquely skilled at a lot of things neurotypical people struggle with.
I am so glad you brought that up. That is 100% true. And please do understand that I'm using quick stories to illustrate something. I'm going a little off subject because I do want to address that. One of my favorite stories of a client with ADHD, I think this is kind of, this is very interesting. So he was a late teenager and his mom was an accountant and his dad was a landscaper. Two careers that are the most non-ADHD that you could have, right? So one day they spilled, this is just what happened. They spilled like a, I don't know what it was, but a caustic something in their basement. And the mom and dad kind of just froze. And the boy like took care of business. You know, he took care of the spill. So you're 100% right. And I always tell people that it's way easier to create an environment in which you fit and feel comfortable than to try to change yourself to fit into an environment. And the clients I've seen with ADHD really thrive at being emergency workers, being kindergarten teachers. You know, it's something that not a lot of people can do. And the one I had was a lobbyist, which I also thought was a brilliant career for someone with ADHD. He had to have that information, but then when he saw someone he needed to talk to, he had to take that chance. He had to take that opportunity. It wasn't planned, but he had to have all that information and be able to just put it all together in that moment. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, and then when nobody's around, he just kind of, you know, his eyes wander. And then he sees someone else and he's like on top of it. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. I in no way meant to say that ADHD was something to be expelled. So more accurately that it was the boy's behavior. And I can't remember what they called the behavior, but I do know his diagnosis was ADHD.
Yeah, but it was like one particular thing in that case where he, you know, where it was like a destructive behavior.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I know one of the kind of more powerful like visualizations or creativity exercises that has helped me a lot with anxiety is just kind of mindfully, like, you know, at night when you're like having like 1,000 thoughts about every horrible thing you've ever done in your life, yeah, you know, like you do, is kind of just the visualization that I'm like, you know, I can welcome these thoughts kind of into my brain. And then like, I'm like over in the VIP section, like of the party, you know, I'm like, welcome, come on in. I see you, you're here, have a good time. But like, I'm busy trying to sleep right now. So that's kind of helped me kind of not think of like my thoughts as like an enemy or something to squash, because that's not how thoughts are, you know, but as kind of just being like, you know, I'm aware that you're here. Or sometimes I will shelve them on a bookshelf, you know, like, I see you, you know, and I recognize you, because that's a lot easier for my brain to kind of then be like, oh, that fact has been recognized. And yeah. Now we'll come back to that later if we want to.
And what I
party or the library, they both work for me.
The things I address with clients, I don't actually address any diagnosis. I address safety, function, and comfort. Are you safe? Is what you're doing working? And are you happy? Mm-hmm. And if part of anxiety is making you unhappy, then we do what we can to make that different. And if part of it is making you unsafe or unhealthy, like not getting your sleep, we change that. But anxiety in and of itself isn't a problem. I'm glad we have people with anxiety. Otherwise, I would not feel comfortable driving over any bridge anywhere, because someone has to say, okay, hold on. Let's.
What if there's an earthquake?
Right. Let's actually test this. What if it falls down? Yeah.
We have a couple comments in chat. Fractal Rainbow says, good story about the spill response. Emergency response is a big skill for ADHD folks.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And Do the Jump says, it's always helped me to reframe my ADHD as sort of an alternate skill set.
I'll never be a
typical person. And no matter how hard I try to be normal, that's a mold that just doesn't fit. But if I focus on what's actually needed for me in any given situation, instead of how I'm supposed to behave, it becomes much easier to bring my strengths to bear. And I love this, because I have a very similar thing that I do. I think it ties right back into the kind of sci-fi fantasy creativity storytelling. And I got this from you, is about the tool belt, you know, like about uh-huh. your superhero tool belt.
Uh-huh.
Or how like you have a toolbox and you have the things that you need. You have the things that you have in your toolbox. You know, some people in their toolbox have like, you know, a hammer and a wrench, and like, you know, my toolbox has like gummy bears in it. But sometimes I need gummy bears, you know, like I feel like my toolbox is like more like a superhero / MacGyver type of tool belt. Uh-huh. And some of the things on it are kind of like not what most people would, you know, say you should have in a toolbox. But, you know, this is my toolbox, and I can put what I want. I have what works for me in it.
Yeah.
You know? If I'm going to use, you know, some rock as a hammer, and that's what works for me, then that's what I have. Awesome.
My toolbox has a security blanket, which isn't a blanket. It's a red snowboard named John. Don't know why. It brings me comfort. So one more quick thing about these aren't necessarily, the diagnosis isn't the problem. The problem is something isn't safe, something isn't working, or something is causing you distress or making you unhappy. And I actually got into, I was going to say trouble, that's not the right word. Many counselors disagreed with me, because over the years I've had actually three clients who met the criteria for psychosis and did not want to take medication. And I really fought for them to not take medication. And one was a teenage girl whose mother was a nurse. So the safety, that kind of addressed the safety. She had hallucinations for sure. Her hallucinations were her grandmother comforting her. And she was functioning fine. She had friends. She was happy. She was safe. She didn't want to take medication to take away those hallucinations. The hallucinations only came at night. We did talk about safety issues and things to look for in case they did become a problem. But I actually had to, just because she met the criteria for a particular diagnosis didn't mean she had a problem. She was safe, she was functioning, and she was happy. And the other client was a Native American writer who had delusions and hallucinations, but he really felt strongly that they helped him write. Mm-hmm. They culturally made sense to him, and he was safe. He was not only functioning, his diagnosis was actually helping him function. It was right. helping him with his job. And he, in his psychosis, the, you know, symptoms actually made him happy.
So that's what's kind of most, and if you're meeting those three things.
Mm-hmm. So, but there are things, there are definitely times where anxiety is important, but anxiety also can cause you to be unsafe or unhappy or not do what you want to do, or symptoms of ADHD can make it difficult to accomplish tasks that you actually want to accomplish. So that's what we're talking about.
So is that what is the issue in the blur? And do you want to read us this little story before we get started on the sci-fi story of our own?
I would love to. So the issue on the blur was a young boy with acting out in unsafe ways when he was angry.
Okay, so it was like an anger management issue.
Yes. So.
And that probably didn't make his parents happy, or his schoolmates, or himself.
And it didn't make himself happy. He got into a lot of trouble, and he felt it was something that was taking him over rather than something he had control over.
Mm-hmm.
So,
but we've split. So we're on my screen share. So while you read the story, I'm going to go to the little like illustrations that I did a while ago for this. And then we'll get started on our sci-fi story.
And this is a story I would say we wrote together. And I'm not going to do any explanation. I'm just going to read it. So the blur. What, can you hear me? Okay, Emerald?
Yeah.
Okay. Once upon a time, there was a boy who was very brave, strong, smart, and handsome.
Mm.
That's how he described himself.
That's so cute.
Yes. His pet lizard, Spike, was the same things too. One day, the boy was hunting in the forest, and a blur, all in capital letters, a blur jumped out from behind a rock. The boy was frightened. He wanted to run away. Spike the lizard tried to chase the blur away, but he was too late. The blur had jumped into the boy's mouth, and no matter how hard the lizard tried to get it out, it wouldn't come out. Oh. Whenever the boy got angry, out would jump the blur. Whenever the boy got scared, out would jump the blur. The blur was jumping out of the boy's mouth more and more. If the blur jumped out of the boy's mouth at home, his mom and dad would send him to his room. If the blur jumped out of the boy's mouth at school, his teacher would send him to the principal's office. If the blur jumped out of the boy's mouth when he was with his friends would stop playing with him. But the boy couldn't stop the blur from jumping out of his mouth. Here comes the exciting part. One day at a garden party, a croquet mallet accidentally hit the boy on the leg. Instead of saying, ouch, the boy got really angry, and the blur jumped out and frightened everybody at the garden party. Spike tried to help the boy stop the blur. But at first, the boy didn't listen to him, and the mean blur stayed in his mouth. Spike and just about all of his lizard friends tried to pull the mean blur out. All the lizards pulled and pulled. Finally, a delightful laugh pushed its way up from the boy's stomach, out of the blur, pushed its way up from the boy's stomach, out of the blur, right out of his mouth. I don't know what that means. The delightful laugh had been trapped behind the blur.
Aww, we all need a delightful laugh.
Yes. And again, that was his word, which I thought was delightful.
Mm-hmm.
The lizards very quickly pushed the blur into a lobster cage, shut the door with the blur trapped inside. The boy was very happy to have his laugh back. His mom and his dad were very happy to have his laugh back. His teachers and his friends were very happy to have his laugh back. Whenever the boy felt the blur starting to bother him again, he would stop and think of something that would make a delightful laugh come out of his mouth and stop the blur from finding its way into the boy's mouth anymore.
Aww. So do you think that story helped this this client kind of deal with that blur issue?
I did. And as you can see in the story, there is not any specific helpful advice other than maybe laughing. But I didn't say, okay, mom, now you got to go buy this boy a lobster cage because that's what's going to help. Or you got to go find a whole bunch of lizard friends.
Right.
It was just having that boy realize that he was powerful enough to decide when the blur had access to him or not, and when laughter had access to him or not.
So yeah.
I do think it helped.
And just like kind of visualizing, it was like a visual metaphor to kind of realize that you don't have to be powerless.
Right. Before we start our story, I'll tell a really quick thing I use when people are feeling scared or going into a situation where they might feel scared.
Okay.
I have them imagine something that they can take with them that makes them feel safe and protected. And it always amazes me what people come up with. For me, you know, I would wear, actually Emerald and I often do this. We wear like earrings that the other person got, like earrings that she bought me, or a heart necklace that I bought her if she has to go into a tough situation. And to her, that means I'm kind of with her, right?
Yeah.
So, but that's kind of practical. So I have people imagine things, you know, wearing a suit of armor. And of course, they're not going to wear a suit of armor, but they're going to have that stance and that way of being and that thought of, I am protected, right? Suit of armor, that's the only reasonable one I can think of. One person brought a shoe tree with her, and she imagined the anger coming towards her from other people as shoes, and she would catch them on the shoe tree. Worked for her.
Yeah.
And I remember one woman, I said, what's one thing that you can take with you that nothing bad can get through? It's what's the opposite of permeable? Impermeable? You know, 100% impermeable. And again, I'm thinking like a brick wall or a suit of armor.
Mm-hmm.
And she said, saran wrap.
Okay.
Right? And she goes, nothing gets through saran wrap. And this woman, the only thing she did, and she told me it worked, her situation was she had a coworker who was undermining her and demeaning her in subtle enough and gaslighting enough ways that she couldn't really confront him and have other people see it. And all she did to change it was she literally took saran wrap to work, put that roll of saran wrap in her desk, just changed her mentality and the way she carried herself or the way she spoke or whatever she did differently.
Yeah. Kind of like that little neural pathway there that she had that protection.
Yeah. And the situation stopped, you know, and she obviously did things differently.
Right.
Before
yeah.
Before she could do things differently, she had to have that neural pathway that said, I am safe.
Yeah,
this saran wrap is keeping me safe. So,
Apocalypse says that an invisibility cloak would be her object. So, are you ready to tell our own story? We're almost at 8 o'clock. So probably go over eight a bit while we write our own story, which
okay,
is
so the first thing I asked.
Let me share my screen again.
Okay. I don't know. I want to get. I'll figure this out. The first thing I tell clients is to describe, actually with kids, I'll do this with Emerald. With kids, I would say, once upon a time, there was a hero named Emerald. And mm-hmm. Emerald was smart and beautiful, but good. And good is the best thing you can be. No, sorry, that's something else. And then I would ask them to describe the hero named Emerald. And that's where that boy came up with smart and brave. So if the first thing I want to ask you is, I don't like the word hero. I don't like the word protagonist. I don't like the word star. So
need a new word, chat.
Need a new word.
That's positive and kind of means like that you're a hero and strong, but it's not like gender based. Like, we were like, protagonist, is that too bland?
Yeah.
And I'll let you elaborate on that after I say these couple things from chat.
Okay, good.
That Do the Jump says they're fascinated with the idea of totems, fetishes, and focuses as mental health tools to give people a sense of power or agency to control over their emotions. Uh-huh. And Sheila DePaulo said, I had an issue, so I wore the thing with Thursday. So I wore the thing that gave me the most strength, my suit of armor, which was a very flowy dress.
Yes, love it, love it. Love it.
Okay, so now we're gonna write our sci-fi story, or do kind of a template example of how a like creativity exercise that you could do at home about kind of how to not conquer your enemy, but how to, you know, deal with, you know, whatever is making you feel unsafe, unhappy. Mm-hmm. Yes.
And I'll tell you too, in doing this, some clients really, really want to like get a pickaxe and beat the bejesus out of whatever they consider the problem. And other people want to send the problem on a vacation in a happy place. Mm-hmm. And other people become friends with the problem. And it's what they want. I don't say, well, you have to destroy that problem.
Yeah. It's kind of like led by them and kind of what they want to do. And there's no one solution fits all, you know,
right.
You're telling your story. It doesn't have to fit to any sort of template. That's the whole idea, is that you're creating something that can be original and create that new neural pathway.
All right, so once upon a time, we're going to take a little bit from everyone. We're going to see what this does. So once upon a time, there was a, I'm going to use the word star. There was a star who was, and what kind of characteristics do the people on chat and Emerald you like most about themselves?
Okay, so we need some positive characteristics. Once upon a time, there was a star. Oh, that's a horrible star.
And I'm going to say, who was chatty and good with analogies. That's me. And I'm just going to use they for now. They were also, what else?
They were... let's see, what is a good quality chat? So diplomatic.
Diplomatic.
Creative is a suggestion. Funny. Oh, it feels weird to say nice things about myself, so I'll say nice things about Emerald. Aw. Apocalypse.
And I'm going to put, and had great hair, because I was telling a story with a client today, and that was really important to him, that he had great hair.
We also have cheerful.
Oh, okay.
And some great hair. I mean, that's kind of subjective. Woo! Some complicated hair, but I think it's pretty cute.
So how about a name for our star?
Okay.
Any suggestions? And again, Emerald, I can't see these, so you can read them. And
I will read them as they come in. So there's a 5-second delay.
Right.
So we have the star of our show, or our hero, for one, you know, we don't need to have a better word. We're still in the kind of describing them.
Right.
And they need a name. Okay, with Cosmo. This is Cosmo.
Star.
That's pretty great, fractal rainbow. I love it. That's almost what I named my cat.
Yeah. The star's name was Cosmo. That's perfect. All right. So the next thing we do is we talk about the helpers that this star had. And you want to think about any, just about any TV show that's has any kind of action in it. I usually think of Buffy or Angel, where you have the star in the middle, and then there's always four or five people kind of V'd out behind them that are helpers.
You know, your sidekicks, or your what's in your toolkit.
Yeah.
Right. So helpers doesn't have to be a being. It could be like the Batmobile. Well, or something like that. So Cosmo needs some helpers, also some straighter lines maybe. Now they look kind of like they're farting. Ooh, Apocalypse says backup dancers, and I love it.
And again, this is very individual, so this is kind of fun to do it with a group. But I've had people name all of their stuffed animals in their room. I've had people say things like, you know, their friends. And then I've also had people, today it was an interesting one, the boy with the great hair. His helpers were Batman, a baseball player named Tatis, who also has a hair.
Sure.
The Black Panther, and Dwayne The Rock Johnson.
That is quite the crew.
Right. But I've also had people, you know, say, you know, Tweety Bird and the creature from the Black Lagoon, you know. Actually, I've never had anyone say those two specific things, but it doesn't matter.
Well, we have eyeglasses, as those are
nice. An
important helper for me, says Apocalypse.
Eyeglasses. I want to know what the eyeglasses' magical qualities were, or comforting qualities. So,
Apocalypse, GGC, we need a magical quality for the eyeglasses. Like, do they help you see ultraviolet light, or do you mean like what do they help you do, like mental health wise?
Either one. Just what, why eyeglasses? And some of this is just opening up your creativity. So I always kind of like to include in there a protector kind of force.
the jump says the eyeglasses make everything taste like lime jello.
Love it. That
is like go gadget lime jello glasses.
Taste like lime jello. For me, that would be helpful if I were the monster or whatever, because you could just like put the lime glasses on me because I hate lime jello. And I'd go away. Let's see.
Here's some backup dancers.
Backup dancers. I'd like a description of the backup dancers. Like, what are they wearing? What do they look like? What's their dance style?
Well, in my picture, they all have stars for heads, and they're all doing the same moves.
Oh, I see now. Got some backup dancers who had stars foreheads.
Well, maybe you just really like lime jello. Maybe that is helpful for you. They're asking in chat how that's helpful. How is it helpful to have glasses?
We don't know.
We don't know. Maybe it'll play a role in sorting.
Yeah, we don't know yet.
And we also have our other helper is a sentient machinist's hammer. So that's their sidekick. I don't know what a machinist's hammer looks like. So we're just going to draw like a regular hammer.
Machinist
hammer.
Love it.
Kind of like an axe. There we go.
And I put in there an angry mother panther because that's what I would like to bring with me.
Okay. So our helpers are, for those of you just tuning in, backup dancers, eyeglasses that make everything taste like lime jello, a sentient machinist hammer, so I guess it's like aware and like offers advice.
Oh, I love it. Yeah.
And
an angry mother panther, which
I
added.
Cool. And an angry mother panther. Grr! Yeah, I'm not going to draw a panther, but there's, you know, cat ears.
And then one day, something comes along that somehow dampens the light of the star. So I'm not going to ask you what about an issue, but I'd like you to, if you could, like, think of your issue, like if your issue were anxiety and you wanted to draw that, or your issue were anger and you wanted to draw that, or your issue were, you know, your brother being a jerk and you wanted to draw that, just how would you draw that if you wanted it to show up like in a Disney film? Like, would it be an evil tarry swamp, or would it be a fluffy bunny, or would it be a vibrating red
herring?
Earring. I was gonna say
herring, but earring.
Oh, earring. Okay.
So when we did this, so you can do this with anything to help you kind of visualize and externalize and kind of come to terms with anything you're struggling with, you know, from like Briscoe keeps jumping on your laptop to like, you know, your very serious, you know, mental health issues or trauma, life issues. And we did this for insomnia once in my you asked me to visualize what my insomnia would look like. And I said, it's like a huge boulder in like on top of me in the bed. So just to reframe, what are we asking for suggestions for now?
So what color, what shape, what form the problem would take? I usually, when people get stuck on this, I usually throw out and say, I usually say it probably wouldn't be a fluffy bunny, right? And I say
is if you're scared of bunnies,
unless you're scared of bunnies.
So this is more of like a purse, like you can think of your own personal thing and you don't have to share it, but like what shape would it, like somehow grounded in the physical realm.
Yes, I like
so you're
it.
Looking for like adjectives. Yeah. Like is it big, is it prickly, is it, you know, is it animate, is it look like an animal, like size, shape, color, is it viscous, is it slimy?
So basically we want it something that Emerald can draw.
Is it something Emerald can draw?
So we don't want to say, hey, the problem is anxiety. We want you to say, hey, the problem is this big brown bear, or the problem is this creepy pink viscous lemonade.
Bunnies, it must be bunnies. That's what Do the Jump said. I didn't just say that.
Yes. It says, so in the little story I'm writing, I say, one day when Cosmo with their eyeglasses, wearing their eyeglasses, was walking along with their backup dancers and angry mother panther, carrying their machinist hammer, out from behind a boulder jumped a
prickly.
Love it.
A beholder. I don't know what that is. All those eyes staring at you. Is it just like a bunch of eyes? Prickly beholder. I don't know what that is, you guys.
That's okay, which I'm going to put in parentheses, which might be just
because there's a bunch of eyes.
And again, that's okay. I've had people say things that I didn't know. I've had them say anime characters, and I don't know anime.
Oh, yeah, or Pokemon, that time you. These are all eyes, clearly.
Oh, it looks like grapes.
Oh, okay. Well, let's give it some, like, lashes, I guess. Sorry, Briscoe's up in my business again. Oh, we also have a squid sphere with a billion eyes. Okay, thank you.
Oh.
A good description too. A sheet of sweaty sandpaper. Ugh. Gross. Oh, Briscoe, you're really hindering the artistic process right here. Ah! Like a lot. So sorry about that, guys.
So after this, I wrote magic wand, but we're going to kind of skip that one. And that's any kind of magic object. But we have the eyeglasses and the sentient hammer. So I think we got that covered. And then just because it's getting a little late, what I usually do with clients is I first have them go through some, you know, what if you tried to get rid of this problem before that didn't work? We can talk about this over the course of 7 sessions sometimes. But what I'm going to ask you guys to do with me is to say that after Cosmo with their eyeglasses and machinist hammer and backup dancers and angry mother panther saw this prickly beholder and sweaty sandpaper jump out, we froze time, and then Cosmo, the eyeglasses, the backup dancers, the angry mother panther, and the machinist hammer got into a huddle and discussed what to do.
Mm.
So to come up with ideas of what to do, how were they going to use all these, the lime jello? Oh no, just tastes like lime jello. Were they going to turn the rock into something that tasted like lime jello and throw it at the, we need a name for this thing too. I don't know what to call it. Oh, well, we'll just call it the
Beholder.
Beholder. And I'm going to call it the beholder with a bunch of R's because I like that. Sounds scarier. Beholder.
So our gang. Yes, get into a huddle. Look at that beholder. It is. Right. And backup dancers are going to come. Like, they're going to dance their way over here to be in the huddle.
I love it.
Panther mama is going to be like, yes, I will huddle over here with you.
And depending on how this is going, sometimes I'll ask my client, you know, what makes the beholder bigger? What makes it smaller? What makes it go further away? What makes it come closer? How long has it been in your life? Why did it pick you? So what does it want from you? What is it trying to teach you? Again, that externalizing whatever that issue is, like what is insomnia trying to protect you from? What is insomnia trying to teach you? Why did insomnia pick Emerald and not another person? What would comfort insomnia enough to make it leave you alone?
Mm. Oh, you know? And then I was like, insomnia is just lonely, this big boulder sitting on my bed. And, yeah. and, you know, so I ended up comforting the big boulder and was like, do you need like a soft blanket? So I gave the boulder a soft blanket, which could make it roll off of the bed or get smaller or something. I don't remember exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. And we did come up with, or you did come up with some practical ideas, like what made the boulder smaller. And you said like chamomile tea.
Yeah.
Something else. Oh, clean sheets.
clean sheets. Yeah.
Well, yeah. I mean, a nice, freshly made bed is always better than a messy. Yeah. So any ideas?
Share the eyeglasses with the beholder. It's so sweaty because it has poor vision and it's squinting so many eye muscles that it's getting tired. I love it.
So I missed the middle part. So I have, they tried sharing the eyeglasses with the beholder who was so many eyes it was getting tired.
So these are ideas that may or may not work, right? This isn't, yeah. Right, okay. So share the eyeglasses with, it's so sweaty because it has poor vision and it's squinting, so many eye muscles that it's getting tired, is what Do the Jump said. But in Apocalypse, it says, it's just got astigmatism and needs some corrective eyewear. Or maybe it really likes lime jello. It could just really like lime jello.
And what did you say right before? Maybe it really likes lime jello.
Just that Apocalypse says it just has astigmatism.
Yes.
And needs some corrective eyewear. These glasses are, there's too many eyes, y'all.
Oh, the eyeglasses are magic, so they can multiply.
Okay.
We're just going to make it that way.
Sure. Makes sense.
All right. Anything else, Em?
That's the suggestion that we have, is that we're giving the lime glasses to the beholder to see if that works. So does this mean we're into like attempting to use our helpers and stuff to defeat the, or improve the situation? Are we on attempt? So I made this fun highlighter thing. I got to use it.
Oh, I kind of skipped over attempts just because of time.
Okay.
Yeah. So this is what we're going to choose.
Okay, so you would in theory, like with a client, or if you wanted to do this for yourself to kind of try to like figure something out, you might try multiple things. You might have like you know, the panther scratch up against the sandpaper and then it makes it nice and soft, or maybe the dancers have a really good sweat towel, you know, to make the beholder less sweaty. And you would try multiple, or like brainstorm kind of multiple things.
Yes. If the person comes up with something right away they love, I don't go back to that. But a lot of times people are feeling kind of dejected and despairing. So they'll say, oh, this doesn't work. This wouldn't work. This wouldn't work. And I just say, oh, cool. And keep going.
Nice.
So how did that make the beholder not a problem anymore? That's the end of the story. Then I'll read it to you guys.
Okay. How can you repeat the question for me who wasn't listening and was trying to make the glasses go like onto the.
So how did giving the beholder glasses make it not a problem for Cosmo anymore? Did it disappear? Did it fade? Did it laugh? Did it jump out the window?
Yeah. So chat, let us know how these magic glasses that make everything taste like lime jello, how did they make the prickly squid eyeball sphere stop bothering Cosmo, the machinist's hammer, and the dancers and the panther. So sweaty. what are some other things that you've had people say that have helped? Like for something like this where it's like, you know, there's not really like a rash rationale necessarily. I mean, I know like right. a lot of you do this with kids.
Yeah.
So they're like very creative about like, oh, well, it just, you know.
Went into a lobster trap.
Yeah, it turned into lime jello.
So the themes are either the thing is destroyed, the thing is fades away, the thing goes to a better place where it's not hurting anybody,
mm-hmm.
or the thing makes friends with the. So those seem to be the common themes
that people bring up mm-hmm. as what happens to their like visualization of the obstacle. Okay, so we have a suggestion, and it's that it, maybe the beholder only looked at and acted scary because they couldn't see the Cosmo.
I love it, and
they were just scared. They were just scared because they couldn't see. So now the beholder can see that it's just our star friend Cosmo, they can just be friends because it won't be scared anymore because Cosmo's clearly a lot of fun and super cool and very friendly. Oh,
I can't type that fast, but I can get the idea.
The beholder only looked and acted scary because they couldn't see Star in their posse and was frightened.
Because it couldn't see Cosmo and the posse clearly. So it was frightened. I already said that. Okay. So did they make friends? Did they just go on their separate ways?
I think that they made friends. And now I think that now that the beholder can see, they don't have to, you know, they can maybe go off on their own adventures if they want to. Oh, yay, nothing banishes fear like familiarity.
Yes.
Yeah, so now they're buddies. No, and they don't have to spend all their time together, but at least they're not like scared of each other. They're holding hands.
All right. So I'm gonna read this story. And I think Emerald posted my website somewhere. If you want to hear more about this, I guess get a hold of GeekGirlCon and I'll try to get some like templates. If you guys want to work on this on your own, I can make some templates. I probably made some. I just have to find them for you to work on.
Yeah, if you share those templates, then we can share them here. Or you on you and your website is upandupwellness.com. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And that's not my counseling website. That's my website with kind of some stuff that I've written and things like that. But yeah, I'll definitely get some templates up there or made available if anyone's interested.
Ooh, can we add to the story that maybe the beholder joins the backup dancers?
Oh my goodness, I had that it joined the posse.
Yay!
So I kind of sometimes tie the story together in a way I like because like I have the power of the typewriter
mm-hmm,
or the keyboard. So So now I'm going to read y'all a bedtime story.
Here we go, bedtime story.
And if I missed part of anything anyone said, it is because I can't type fast. I loved all the ideas. Okay. So we're going to call this Lime, the name of the story. I like this for the name of the story. Lime Jello question mark. And that'll get people interested.
Lime Jello question mark?
Lime Jello. Or something like that. Like, lime jello is a weapon? What? Okay. Once upon a time, there was a star who was chatty and good with analogies. They were also diplomatic, creative, funny, cheerful, and had great hair. The star's name was Cosmo. Cosmo had some helpers. The helpers that Cosmo had were eyeglasses that made everything taste like lime jello, backup dancers who had stars for heads, an angry mother panther, and a sentient machinist's hammer. One day, when Cosmo, with their eyeglasses, was walking along with their backup dancers and angry mother panther carrying their machinist's hammer, out from behind a boulder, that's just something I like to do, out from behind a boulder jumped. Mm-hmm. Out from behind a boulder jumped a prickly beholder, which might just be a bunch of eyes, but was actually a squid sphere with a bunch of eyes and sweaty sandpaper. I know I missed part of it there. Sorry, I'll stay in this story.
Mm-hmm.
They tried sharing the eyeglasses with the beholder. It was sweaty and squinting and had so many eye muscles it was getting tired.
It had
an astigmatism and needed collective eyewear.
Yeah, let's get some sad eyebrows.
And maybe it really liked lime jello. So, since the eyeglasses were magic, they could multiply and fit the beholder's eyes, and still Cosmo could keep their own glasses. The beholder only looked and acted scary because it was frightened, because it couldn't see Cosmo and the posse clearly. So they made friends, and the beholder became part of the posse and sometimes danced with the backup dancers, and sometimes went off on their own adventures, and sometimes stayed with the posse. Nothing banishes fear like familiarity.
Oh, nice tagline.
Yeah. I am going to say nothing banishes fear like lime jello and familiarity.
So true.
So that kind of not only creativity, but sense of fun. Really does help create those new neural pathways. So any feedback, any questions before I go to bed and Emerald tries to go to bed but has insomnia?
Let me check the chat. And then we'll do, so any final questions about the story or making your own story or just comments on neural pathways or sci-fi, if you wanted to chime in with your favorite science fiction story from the beginning and why, that's cool too. And then we'll bid you a fond farewell. Let me check the chat. Bakla says, aww. I feel like that, like, nothing. What was the tagline there? Familiarity and lime jello?
Nothing banishes fear like familiarity and lime jello.
Nothing banishes fear like familiarity and lime jello. That's like a good, like, I want to get that as a tattoo or something, maybe. I don't know. Well, while we're waiting to see if there's any final questions, I'll just do kind of some outro announcements about before we go. Here's what's upcoming on the GeekGirlCon channel is on Thursday. We're playing Deep Rock Galactic, which is a co-op game about dwarves mining in space. And then on Saturday, GeekGirlCon has a special bonus stream. We usually only stream Tuesdays and Thursdays at 7 Pacific time. But Saturday at 2, we have a bonus stream, and Christina will be leading GGC RPG. The continued
soul-making.
Yeah, TBD, TBH. The continued adventures of Coyote and Crow, which is a native designed RPG, sci-fi fantasy set in an alternate future. And that's been a lot of fun. And just another reminder that we are still, GeekGirlCon is still fundraising for the in-person con. So if you want to go to that give big page and hit that up, that would be amazing and awesome and super cool. And I don't think we have any further questions, just thank yous. We have Fractal Rambo says thank you for the storytelling and mental health tips, or storytelling. I don't know why I said that weird. I love the Do the Jump says I love the storytelling mechanism for framing skills to cope with struggles. Thank you for sharing this with fun. Apocalypse says GGC 23 theme, familiarity and lime jello. Yay. And GeekGirlCon has dropped that give big link there in the chat, so check that out to see what's up. And just you want to say who were you this stream? Who did we have guesting tonight, Mother Dear? Who are you?
I don't understand what you're asking.
Who has this been? Like, what's like the sign off on like a radio or TV show? You know, it'd be like, this has been Geralyn Peterson, licensed mental health counselor with Psych-Fi, storytelling for mental health improvement, neural pathway story.
This has been lime jello manufacturer. No.
this stream is not sponsored by lime jello.
This has been mental health counselor and someone who believes everybody's goal in life is to become more truly themselves. Geralyn Peterson and mother to a very amazing daughter.
That's me. Yay, moms.
Thanks for sharing all your ideas. This was a blast. I love doing this. And thanks for your questions and the points you made and brought up. I do think there's still mental health stigma out there. And that's one of the reasons I like doing this. One of the funnest parts about being a mental health counselor is finding a fun way to handle problems and laughing and being creative with my clients. And it's a gift to me when I get to do that.
Yeah, you're building neural pathways too.
Yeah.
Aww.
Aww.
Well, thank you so much, Mom, for joining us on this Sci-Fi Geek Girl Con adventure. Mm-hmm. And we'll see you on but we'll see you, Twitch watchers, on Thursday for some gaming, Deep Rock Galactic. And that's it. So have a good night. Write your own story. Build your own paths.
Literally and figuratively. Or literally and what's the other word?
Both. Jello.
Yes, jello.
Metaphorically.
I'm craving lime jello. I don't know why.
I know. I guess we, so now we say smile and wave.
Bye. Thank you guys. It was really fun.
We'll eat lime jello.
Enjoy lime jello. I just love these stories. I'm gonna flesh this one out a little bit, I think.
And you're gonna flesh it out?
No, flesh it out. You flesh out a story. You flush out birds. And maybe I'll post it on the Facebook page or something as a story if anybody.
Yeah, we should.
Yeah.
Bye.
I like it. Bye. Bye. My.